Are you going to play a song first?
No. Go ahead.
Oh, okay. Good evening. My name is Hortense Crozier Perfect, and I will be your moderator for this evening's class. Welcome to another lecture given by the Ontario Archetype Pattern Workshop. This is a school and not a church. Neither are we affiliated with any religious organizations. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh or Elohim and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as a result of a divine vision and divine revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. We hold classes in the United States, Canada, Jamaica, and certain other foreign countries. The Archetype Pattern Workshop was established in February of 2021. In this school, we use the true, correct, original name and title of the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted with Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted with God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifested in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted with Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5 that there are Lords many and God's many. But we now know that each Lord must have a name and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. That means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A detailed investigation on your part in any good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew, Greek, or Latin languages have any characters or letters in their alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in our English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus or Jehovah are impossible renderings of the true and original name of our Father and his Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, he is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, the limits and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state, symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape or form. We have drawn this cloud all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man but without flesh and blood. This shape and form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now, there is only one name given unto salvation, and we must all know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should all ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title can be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai, and he showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. Yahweh instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. The pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In this school, we show proof that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The 10 primary constitutional objectives and aims are as follows. First, to help you find and know Yahweh or Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Second, to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race or nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third, to investigate the unexplained spirit law or so-called law of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth, to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons, operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And 10th is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is speak the truth. We will have a prayer this evening by Dr. Vercel Mack, a selection of music, and our scripture lesson is Galatians, the first chapter, and that will be read by Dr. Eunice Reiser. Dr. Mack?
Good evening, class. Let's take a moment to bow in our hearts and mind and give a prayer to our Heavenly Father, Yahweh. Yahweh, thank you for once again allowing us to come together to know anything about you, your pattern, and your plan. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for causing us to be able to walk, be steadfast, and have all faith in you. Thank you for your long suffering with us. And thank you for actually showing us. We actually see you, the effectual working of you. We see this in, not just in class, we see this every day of our lives. And we're so grateful that you have taken us from darkness. There are so many people that are out there that are lost, and you gave much mercy to give us an opportunity to come and love you and give the respect that is due to you. All these things and many more, in the name of your only begotten Son, Yahshua the Messiah. Hallelujah.
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 Oh,
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Good evening, class. Our scripture lesson will be taken from Galatians, the first chapter, page 250. And I'll be reading from the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts revised by the late A.B. Trainum. Galatians, the first chapter. Saul, an apostle, not of men, neither by man, but by Yahshua the Messiah and Yahweh the Father, who raised him from the dead, and all the brethren which are with me unto the assembly of Galatia. Grace be unto you and peace from Yahweh the Father and from our Savior, Yahshua the Messiah, who gave himself for our sins, that he might deliver us from this present evil age, according to the will of Yahweh our Father, to whom be glory forever and ever. I marvel that ye are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of the Messiah unto another evangel, which is not another, but there be some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of the Messiah. But though we are an angel from heaven, preach, but though we are an angel from heaven, preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. As we said before, so say I now again, if any man preach any other evangel unto you than that ye have received, let him be accursed. For do I now persuade men or Yahweh? Or do I seek to please men? For if I yet please men, I should not be the servant of the Messiah. But I tell you, brethren, that the gospel which was preached of me is not after man. For I neither received it of a man, neither was I taught it, but by the revelation of Yahshua the Messiah. For ye have heard of my conduct in time past in the Jews' religion, how that beyond measure I persecuted the assembly of Yahweh and wasted it, and profited in the Jews' religion above many my equals in my own nation, being more exceedingly zealous of the tradition of my fathers. But when it pleased Yahweh, who separated me from my mother's womb, and call me by his grace to reveal his son to me, that I might preach him among the nations, immediately I conferred not with flesh and blood, neither went I up to Jerusalem to them which were apostles before me, but I went into Arabia and returned again unto Damascus. Then after 3 years, I went up to Jerusalem to see Peter and abode with him 15 days. But other of the apostles saw I none, save James, the brother of the Savior. Now the things which I write unto you, behold, before Yahweh I lie not. Afterwards I came into the region of Syria and Cilicia, and was unknown by face unto the assemblies of Judea, which was in the Messiah. But they had heard only that he which persecuted us in time past now preached the faith which once he destroyed, and they glorified Yahweh in me. I have read Galatians, the first chapter. Let us all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Dr. Mack and Dr. Reiser. This is Thursday, our open lecture, our testimony. First speaker, I would like to call on Dr. Roxanne Mitchell.
I didn't open my mic. He's talking. Good evening, everyone. I'm so glad to be here. And Yes, I would like to give a testimony. Just like you guys to know how much I just depend on Yahweh for everything. I couldn't live a second without him. We all look to him and try to learn what we can about his purpose and plan for us. And I know some of us are lost and I just can't understand, but I know it's Yahweh's purpose. Some people are just so lost and in the dark, and you just can't tell them anything about the doctrine they believe in, even though. Also, I just want to say this before I go there. I have aphasia, the same as what Bruce Willis and Wendy Williams has, but mine is milder. But I do, and that's a reason why sometimes I don't like to speak. Stuff just will just blank out of my head and I'm lost. But Yahweh have allowed me to be able to continue on. And I do forget things. I'll forget I even took my medicine for the day. And then I have to just keep thinking back and try to remember. And sometimes I just won't take it because I'm afraid that I'm going to take the medicine again. So you guys can excuse me if I start with my words, especially in the evening. I'm more loosened in the morning, but in the evening things are not that good. I'm not really articulate, I should say it. But Yahweh has allowed me to continue to understand, and I'm really starting to understand my purpose, his purpose and pattern. When I first came to class and I saw the Elohim, the archetype pattern of the universe chart, I just looked at it like, oh my God, I'm never gonna get this stuff. But when I ask myself questions, I can come up with the right answers just from the lectures or teachings that I have received since I've been here. I think it's almost 3 years now that I've been in the class. And I'm so glad Yahweh called me to this class and meeting all of you guys. And I really, really want to meet you guys in person someday, the Ontario class. Because I've watched several Zoom classes, but I've always come back to you guys because I really enjoy this class, and especially the lecturers. And I just hope everyone who's called to this class, I know everyone loves this teaching because it is the true doctrine. Our Father, our Heavenly Father is the true God. And, you know, I've tried to explain, and I've explained it the way it's been taught to me. But, you know, some people, you just know, they get so upset with you. So a lot of, and they'll just, you know, you explain everything and it's, oh, I get it, I love it. But then you'll talk to them maybe a month later and they are just back to that, oh, I just, you know, I pray to God, I said Lord, I'm like, oh my goodness. So I don't say anything, you know. You can't force a person. I guess they have to be called by Yahshua. And I wish that more people would come out of the dark. But the people that are here and going through this teaching, we know this is the true teaching. We know that Yahweh Elohim is our true Father, and I really hope he called my grandson to this teaching. I tell him about it, and he make like he's interested, but he's really not. And I figured that out, so I don't even mention it to him anymore. But nothing is going to stop me from coming to class. And I have a lot of issues. I'm going through a lot of health issues, but I'm getting better. And new things pop up, but nothing's going to stop me, and nothing's going to keep me down. Because as long as Yahweh Elohim allow me to keep going, I am going to keep going. And I just want to say thank you for this teaching, and thank you for this Zoom class. Because I don't know what would I do without it. I enjoy it very much, so please don't ever stop. And I guess that's it for tonight. Oh, and once I get off, I'm going to think of so many other things I wanted to say, but I can't think of them now. And that's because of the aphasia. Just, it's so frustrating sometimes when I want to say something and it, I forget it, and it's so frustrating I can't get it back. And I know what I want to say, and sometimes I want to say something and it comes out completely wrong. So don't think I don't love this teaching, because I do, because I never speak up. I do love it, but I know I have this disease that I deal with. But thank you, Yahweh, for allowing me to be here and learn everything I can about you, because I love this teacher. Thank you, Ontario class, and all the other members, my brethren. Thank you. Love you all. You guys have a good evening. Thank you.
Hallelujah.
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 Thank you, Dr. Mitchell. For our next speaker, I will call on Dr. Vercel Mack.
Okay. Well, good evening, brethren. And I thoroughly enjoyed the remarks, the testimony of the previous speaker. Everything that comes from the heart, like, we're here to learn, and it's teaching, and, you know, to learn all that we can know. But you come to understand that it's Yahshua the Messiah that gives all revelations. Some are going to have this, some are going to have that, or whatever the case may be. You know, you can hear the love that we actually have for our Savior. And it is a beautiful thing. It is a beautiful thing to be here, to be called here out of this world. And I, again, I really appreciate the remarks from the previous speaker. And I really appreciate Yahshua calling us in here, you know, because everyone is just not called. And we're going to preach what it is that we, what he's given us to understand, you know, and it breaks our heart as far as our families or friends or loved ones, and even people we don't know, because we all were Gentiles. We understand now that we, how we are not, how we are spiritual Israel now, you know, and you want to tell everybody, because it really is the good news. And it's just like if you've seen somebody's the house burning or something, and you just want to tell them that the house is burning, but they don't see it. So we leave all things to Yahweh, you know, because he actually has not lost not one. Yahshua has not lost one. Not one will be lost. And, you know, and I'm grateful for that. You know, we have to, he's going to do what he's going to do. It's his purpose. Just as he called us in here and told us his name, he called us in here. And I'm like, I'm really, really, because you think about it more and more every day, because this is about our soul. So he called us in here and he gave us his name. He called us in here and he taught us, first of all, that how he even contacts a man. Now, that's in Numbers 12 and 6, but, you know, where that they're going to have a divine vision, and come later on to understand it's going to be a divine revelation, you know, to even understand this. That's what happened to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in Ohio, state of Ohio, in the year of 1931. And so, you know, because where I come from, all the preachers said I was called. Everybody was called, you know. And no, but there is a way that he contacts a man. We learned that that's how he contacted Moses. But they had a vision. They saw Yahweh Elohim. All of the prophets, that's who they saw, Yahweh Elohim. Later on, he manifests in the flesh for the world to see as Yahshua the Messiah, as the world, as in the moderation says, erroneously calls Jesus Christ. I used to say it a lot in class that the J have the people hooked, you know? And so just things that we take, not even take for granted, but some people may think that it's little because we've been knowing this. No, no, no. All it is to this day is still significant. He taught us that that he did not come in to institute a way, the Christian way of living. He taught us that he was back there with Moses. And that's in Exodus 24 and 13. But that, and his minister rose, you know, Moses was called up on that mountain alone. But his minister, Joshua, which is Joshua, or really Yahshua, because no J, no Jesus, it's Yahshua, the son of Nun. That was phenomenal to me to this day, that he was back there the entire time, and he instituted, he gave them the law. He gave them the law, and it wasn't just 10 commandments and Leviticus. It was 613 different laws and ordinances and things like that. And then he knew it was always purpose. See, that's another thing. No one knew that Yahweh had a purpose. I definitely did not know that he had a purpose. And he comes in and he institutes this law. And he institutes it where they can't keep it. So he's going to come in. He tells us that, think not that I have come to destroy the law, but to fulfill it. Because why would he destroy it? Everything, his word will not return to him void. So he comes in and he fulfills the law. Everything that was written in law, everything that was testified by the prophets, and he fulfilled it and he completed that and brought it to an end. He taught us that the difference, I came in here and found out the difference between a Hebrew or a Jew and a Gentile. So, you know, I, of course, heard the word Gentile before, but I didn't know how I was one. And we come in here and we learn that anybody who is not of Hebrew descent is a Gentile. So that's everybody else. Everybody else in the world is a Gentile, or as he referred to them as nations, okay? So it's, and then a good question, he even taught us the questions to ask. Okay, well, if you came and the law was given to the Israelites or the Hebrew people, what about me? Because that wouldn't seem fair. Oh, but he has all of these things taken care of. It was always part of the purpose. First of all, he says in John 4, and let me get this. I'm going to pull this out. So to fulfill means to complete and bring to an end. So he brought that to an end, and he ushered in a new age. And John 4 and 24, I'm going to get it.
I got it.
Okay, thank you, sis.
John 4:24. For Yahweh is spirit.
I'm sorry, let's start at 23.
Yes. But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. For Yahweh is spirit. And they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth.
Thank you. We didn't know anything about spirit. And we know, we thought we knew the truth, but we did not. We were deceived, just as Eve was. You know, we were deceived and lied to. Some people call it hoodwinked and bamboozled, but that was even part of Yahshua, Yahweh's plan, his purpose anyway. So he now, can we have the... call it the old covenant, new covenant chart. Thank you. Now, all of these things, they were under the law. All of these cardinal ordinances, the circumcisions, the ceremonies, the baptisms, The everything that they had to do, Israel, physical Israel, back there under the law. When he came in and fulfilled it, you see it says right there, he nailed to the cross. He nailed it to the cross. And he was the ultimate sacrifice. You know, that's why you're going to see the 4 points of blood, you know, and I'm getting ahead of myself. But again, that's how he fulfilled it. And he moved it out the way. Now the New Testament. Now they tell us that the New Testament is Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And that's not correct. Again, he has taught us, he's raised us and taught us the truth that those are biographies pretty much about him. Not even pretty much, these are biographies about him. There's a flyleaf in your Bible that says the New Testament that tells you that the New Testament is written in our hearts and mind. Can I have right. Jeremiah 31 and 31? Jeremiah.
Behold.
Okay, I'm sorry. I will help you out. You know, we work together. Okay.
Okay. Behold, the days come, saith Yahweh, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah.
Okay.
Not so according to.
Covenant. I'm sorry. So,
go ahead.
New covenant, that's the New Testament. This is written in your heart and mind. Okay, read.
Not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, which my covenant they break, although I was a husband unto them, saith Yahweh.
Okay, so the first covenant and all of these things were purpose. You see where he said, which my covenant they break. That is why Moses broke the first tables of stone. On that second trip, when he went up there, Yahweh showed him the 7 days of creation. And the next 33 days on that second trip, he actually showed him the tabernacle, how to everything to the next 33 days was about the tabernacle. And I think that's in Exodus 25. But Moses, when he saw them, the last thing he actually saw before Yahweh told him that there was a noise in the camp, he saw the 7 days of, he saw the creation in 6 days, and he saw Adam and Eve in the garden, and he saw them, you know, in heaven. They were at peace. Okay. Right. But so he comes down. Now they have broken the law, you see. So he waxed hot and he threw down those tables of stone. So, and it was always purpose because, you know, he did not, on that third trip, he got to see the rest of it. It was a recapitulation. And then he showed him about the genealogies and things like that. He was up there 40 days. And you know what? After that second trip, I think it's called Blood, Water, and 40. It's a transcript I'm reading. I did not know that that after that second trip, that Moses, because he tried to repent for Israel, he actually fasted and prayed to Yahshua for 40 days before he actually went up on that third trip. But anyway, that's the first testament. I mean, the first covenant is going to be broken because it was always purpose for it to be the second covenant to actually in that, those tables of stone to actually go into the Ark of the Covenant. But okay, read.
33, but this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith Yahweh. I will put my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts and will be their Elohim and they shall be my people.
Okay, thank you. See, it's all in the heart and mind now. Spirit, you know, you'll see all over the charts where it's showing his heart, and it's the spirit of Yahshua. It's his heart. And you know, that's another thing. When those first tables of stone were broken, they broke his heart. See, Israel has been Israel mm-hmm. for a really, really long time, you know, and it really is the mercy of Yahweh, and he is the true discerner of the heart and mind. He actually, they talk about Santa Claus, he knows when you're sleeping. No. This is about Yahweh. It's his omnipresence. And you know what? So anyway, he actually ushers in a new age. And so again, well, how are we incorporated? How, you know, what does that mean for the Gentiles? So we're going to go to Ephesians. Because this is Paul talking, and he's talking, you know, Paul is the prophet or the apostle for the Gentiles, and he has a lot of different books. So I'm going to go to Ephesians 1 and 4.
Ephesians 1 and 4. According as he has chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love, having predestined us unto the adoption of children by Yahshua the Messiah to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will.
Okay, so we were adopted, and it doesn't even matter. We are all part of purpose. You know, he did a way to where, because remember, he died for the world. You see, but he has a purpose, and he knows who he actually is, who he has actually chosen as his bride. And this goes off into so many other different things, but predestinated, because the end was declared from the beginning. It was always purposed for us to be together, gathered here. You know, I heard Roxanne talking about, I wish that I could meet you all. And, you know, and that's how I feel too. We haven't met each other physically so, but we all have met each other spiritually. So we are in one accord. And, you know, before this earth, whatever was, it was always purpose for this to be going on right now at this particular time. And time was only set up because Yahweh resides in the realm of eternity. Time was set up just for his purpose. And just like, you know, Yahweh spoke this creation in, but he slowed it down for Moses. You see, he gave him 6 solar days. He slowed it down, and he's showing us that he's slowing it down for us to give us more of an understanding, because in all honesty, the end of the age is 1960. I was born after the end of the age. We are in grace period right now. We are in, this is mercy, that he's still sitting on this mercy seat. So we were always purposed to be here, but let's go down to 9.
9. Having made known unto us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he has purposed in himself.
See, so it's a purpose. He has, like, this is significant. This is nothing happenstance. This was always purpose. And again, can we show the dispensation chart? Because again, come in here. He will teach you everything. Now in Romans 1:19 and 20, I'm not quoting it, but it's saying it's going to take the physical things to show you the spiritual things. It's right. What we call light and shadows, the things that you see that you can, like when you go to sleep at night and put the cover over you and then go to sleep. So that's a death, because sleep is likened to death. You cover yourself with the covers, you're buried. And then and you wake up resurrected in the morning, you know, Yahweh willing, hallelujah. But that's just a type and shadow to show us something, taking something physical to show us something spiritual. And see here, the dispensations. A dispensation is the divine ordering of affairs. So we have 7 ages and 7 dispensations. And he's showing me different things now. You know, he's causing this because it's not overnight. I want you to know that there's no pressure here. This is a school of the highest learning, but this is not Harvard or Yale. And it's not to be taken that way. See, because Harvard and Yale, they have their whole thing as far as their status and this and that, you know, and no disrespect to anyone who actually has, it could be somebody in class who actually did go to Harvard and Yale. But this is a spiritual class. So it's no pressure. It's no trying to outdo the other or anything like that. There's no race against each other. You see, the race is actually within ourselves. But anyway, Yahweh has 7 ages and dispensations, because we have 7 days in a week. Like we are here in the sixth dispensation. I know that Paul was in the fifth dispensation. I see that Yahshua came in the fourth dispensation, and he's still working with me as far as being able to take the elementary chart and actually be able to rightly divide the ages on this dispensation chart. But I just want to pull that up because the whole thing is for that in the dispensation of the fullness of time. You see where it says in, right here on this line. This is the fullness of time. This is Yahshua the Messiah because he came in to fulfill. This chart mm-hmm. also reminds me of, oh gosh, now I was supposed to go up this, the chart, but in a holy place where the seven branch, the golden lampstand, you know, right. How that it was seven different branches, right? But the middle branch is where they poured the oil. They poured that oil and it filled up, it filled it all up simultaneously. And you know, this is him gathering all things to himself, just little things that he show you that is actually just a treat. So in the fullness of time, that was when Yahshua came in and went through a death, burial, and resurrection, and you know, ascension. But he fulfilled. That's what we're talking about, that law that he just put, he just moved it out the way so we can actually have an opportunity to be adopted, you know, according to his purpose, and to know our Heavenly Father the way he really is and actually exists. But read on.
The 10, that in the dispensation of the fullness of time, he might gather together in one all things in the Messiah, both which are in heaven and which are on earth, even in him, in Read. Whom also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestinated according to the purpose of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his own will.
See, and there's that word purpose again. Again, these are small things, the world things, but it's like this is actually significant because that's the only way you're actually going to know him the way he really is and actually exists, well, starting with his name. But he actually has to reveal these things to you. And seeing back there in 9 where it says, having made known to us a mystery. That's another thing. No one figured this out. It was always purpose. So I don't care how smart you think you are. We know more than what Einstein know, and I know I was not smarter at all to this day than Einstein, but I know in the mercy and the grace of Yahshua the Messiah and Yahweh that I know his purpose, and he's just teaching me more and more every day. So I want to go to, okay, and you know what? Let's keep reading. 12.
12. That we should be to the praise of his glory, who first trusted in the Messiah, in whom ye also trusted after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after that ye believed, ye were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise.
See, hallelujah, because the whole thing, we trust him. We don't have to trust anyone anymore. Now listen, Yahweh has raised able-bodied ministers and you know, and he continues to raise them no matter what level of understanding you have, you know, that because it's him that's given it to you. It's him. He's given everybody their portion and we trust, we believe. See, who have believed the report? What is the report? You see, the report is, oh man, 1 Corinthians 15, 1 and 4. We love him. And we're so grateful and thankful to actually be here while people are running around. And we're not making a mockery. We're not mad at the people at all. It's the doctrine that we're talking about. And again, none of us should actually be ever feeling like we are. Israel was hard-hearted and stiff-necked back then. Israel is still the same way now. It is time to be humble and actually listen to the Father, not listen to yourself, you know, or what you think something is, and all of these different things, or how you see things, because the way you see things may not be the way it is. And I, right. Yes, 1 Corinthians 15:1. Thank you.
Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also ye have received, wherein ye stand,
right,
by which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I have preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain.
Right. Right.
For I delivered unto you, first of all, that which I received, how that Yahshua died for our sins, according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day, according to the scriptures.
Thank you. We want you to know that the scriptures, not the entire Bible, is, you know, this is the book, but the scriptures are the law and the prophets, what they call the Old Testament, what these preachers don't want to talk to you about or tell you about, because actually they don't really, really know what it's about. But those are the scriptures. And I'm just going to Isaiah 8:20.
The law into the testimony. Okay. To the law and to the testimony. If they speak not according to this word, it is because there is no light in them.
So that's what we preach, the law, the prophets, or the testimony, and the fulfillment of Yahshua the Messiah. These are the things that he actually has taught us. Now he's taught us how, you know, that we're no longer Gentiles. How? Because he has taken us from darkness. And you know what? I'm not going to be up here long, but it's like things are just pouring in my head right now, you know, and it's just been on my heart and mind. Where are we? Where do I want to go? I'm trusting y'all. Okay, I'm going to Colossians. I'm going to go to Colossians, sis. Colossians. Okay. Colossians 1:9.
Colossians 1:9. For this cause we also, since the day we heard of it, do not cease to pray for you, and to desire that you might be filled with the knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding.
My first aim is to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, the way he really is and actually exists. We have to know, and it's by revelations. And okay, and read on.
That ye might walk worthy of Yahweh unto all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of Elohim.
Now, we have been admonished to learn all that we can know, learn all that we can, because he said that we're going to need it, but we actually need it right now, you know. So that is actually why we're in class. That is why Yahshua has us here, to actually learn all that we can know, all that we can listen, all that he actually reveals to us, because that's another thing I used to try to also upset, because I can't remember different scriptures, and I can't remember this. And he told me, don't worry about what you don't know. You see, you just stand on what you do know. And this is not to be misconstrued as far as someone just not wanting to learn anything, or just being lazy, or don't want to, you know, don't want to take the time out. See, you know, you can lead a water, lead what they say, you can lead the horse to the water, but you can't
right.
lead them. See, so it's like we have to let Yahweh do what he does. It's not what other people may see or what other people may think, because this is what's really been on my heart and mind. Can we just go ahead and read 11?
Strengthening with all might according to his glorious power, unto all patience and long suffering with joyfulness.
Right.
giving thanks unto the Father, which has made us fit or meet to mm-hmm. be partakers of the inheritance of the sons in light.
3.
Who has delivered us from the power of darkness and has translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son.
3.
In whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sin.
Hallelujah. Because he actually did come. And see, this was not just God's little boy, Jesus. We understand that this was Yahweh himself, you know, right. manifesting. You know, I come in my Father's name and you receive me not. Let another come in his own name. Him you will receive. Yahshua. Yeshua right. means salvation or the Savior. It's only one name up there. Yahweh is salvation. Yahweh is a Savior. And this is what's been on my heart and mind lately. About because the fact that giving thanks to him, 12, that giving thanks unto the Father, which hath, H-A-T-H, he's already done it. He has made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the sons of light, who hath, H-A-T-H, he hath delivered us from the power of darkness and hath translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son. Now, what has been on my heart and mind, because we say that and we do know that. Listen, when he came and told us who he was, so we could not no longer worship Baal. We would no longer call him Lord or Ishi or God. You know, those are titles. There's not names. You know, he actually opened up and revealed himself unto us. But those are the things he changed. That was a major thing that he changed us from, that he brought us from. We see all of this stuff going on around us. It is stinging darkness around us right now. And we are the light through him, not of our own volition at all. The light is the Holy Spirit within you and me and us, you see. But we talk about this part a lot where we're, you know, because, you know, we're so Holy Spirit. We have the Holy Spirit. And we do, you know, we do. But there are so many things that he is still delivering us from. And I'm not talking about two spirits in a body that does not exist. It is a process. So while we are not all of us, but you know how they talk about you read over things a lot? Well, just with this one right here, this is the main thing. This is really how he took us from life, from death to life. Because, you know, it's in the scripture, if you confess with your mouth that Yahweh actually did send one, Yahshua the Messiah himself, and raised him from the dead, then you will be saved. Now, I'm not quoting, but that was a major thing. Nobody, and I can't say nobody, but we need to consider there are so many other things. Because we have the Holy Spirit and we know this teaching. It's not like we walk on water, not right now, you know, and it's just, you know, it's a lot of different things that are going on because again, Israel is Israel. You see, they were hard-hearted and stiff-necked back then and it's still happening now. Now, listen, Dr. Kinley said, I'm not kicking about it. I'm talking about just being able to discern and to actually see what's going on. See, Yahweh is not condescending. We are saved by grace. We are not, there's no, in Romans 8:1, and we don't have to get it, but there's no more condemnation. So preach whatever it is that the Father has given you to preach. Teach whatever it is that the Father has given you to teach. And then you just let him take care of the rest. Because we don't want to assume what somebody is not doing or what somebody don't know, you know what I'm saying? Or they should be here and all this different thing because you don't know what Yahweh is dealing with each and every last one of us individually. See, we are the body, the bride of Yahshua, the Messiah, and we are supposed to admonish each other and lift each other's arms up. We are supposed to beseech each other because can we have those two plates on the elementary chart? The last two plates, because he's not playing. So we actually know that we need to be obedient. We need to be obedient. But it is him that is causing the obedience. I believe in trusting Yahweh. I don't even trust myself. I don't have to. I surrender. It's on autopilot for me to actually, so I don't need anyone to try to condemn or tell me what it is that I should do or anything like that. Because, you know, it's said about doing if we did a detailed investigation, you know, we should do a detailed investigation before we make any kind of decision. Well, when it comes down to individuals, you know, the brethren, you do not know what Yahweh is working with each individual on. The first speaker just talked about all of the things that she's going through, you know, and, you know, I can't remember and different things like that. But Yahweh has her here speaking strong. She has love for Yahweh. Now, listen, you know, and that is what's going to show, because you see right here, this apostate church, this is why we were supposed to be in school, so we can learn how to preach against these things, because that's where we are. This plate right here, this is where we are right now. Because we, you know, he has identified the Pope, the 666, you know, the carnal ordinance being restored. This, you guys can look and see that the world is, this country and the world is Babylon. We can see all. So this is where we are right now. And the next plate is the last plate, because death and hell will be cast into the lake of fire. So he's not playing. And the beginning of knowledge is the fear of Yahweh. So we know that because he's dealing with us individually. So he's talking to each and every last one of us. So I don't have any kind of pressure on me, you see, there's no kind of expectations. The only expectations are coming from the Messiah and coming from Yahweh himself, because he knows what he's revealed to you. So we can't make assumptions what Yahshua is doing within these vessels, because we are still every day, there's no righteousness in us right now, saving the Holy Spirit that's in us, but there's no perfection in us. And he showed me that he did that on purpose to keep us humble, to keep us worshiping him. So it's just, I want to, you know, we say it all the time, that this is a school and it's not a church. When you be honest though, you see some church-like behavior going on, because people are people, no matter where you put them. And so, and again, nothing to kick about, because this is actually all Yahweh's purpose. You're showing me more and more to discern. All you need to do is know what's in a vessel so you can know which way to move, but actually keep looking at yourself. So they're telling us and examine ourselves, because again, we do need to know as much as we can know, but examine yourself. But it's not going to only be in knowledge. You better examine your heart and mind. I'm asking him to, I don't even want to examine myself, because I may not see something. I may think I'm okay, and I'm not. Examining yourself to make sure that you stand. And I want Yahweh, the Holy Spirit himself, to actually examine me so he can tell me where I'm wrong. So, and you can see the effects of working where he's causing you. It is him causing you to actually do that. So it's just, you know, it's just good to discern. There's nothing to kick about, you know. One of the brethren, like, just get your popcorn and actually just remain humble and let Yahshua do what it is that he has made you meet to do. That, you know, because he knows this is his purpose. It's his purpose. So some of the things that, I'm not going to go there, but I'm going to read this last scripture and I'm going to get down, because somebody else may want to speak, you know, but I want to get Ezekiel 36. Mm. 36 and 24.
Thirty-six, twenty-four.
Yes. Let me read. I got it.
For I will take you from among the heathen.
And I'm sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off. I will take you from among the heathen. And I definitely was a heathen. because all died in Adam. You know, the time man actually has an excuse. He doesn't even know. You come in here and you find out that it is not even your fault. It was his purpose that all, you know, all died in Adam, and the creature was subjected to vanity, not of any will of his own. This is part of the purpose, but he's taken us from the nations. He's taken us from the world. Read.
For I will take you from among the heathens and gather you out of all countries and will bring you into your own land. Then will I sprinkle clean water upon you, and ye shall be clean. From all your filthiness and from all your idols will I cleanse you. A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. And I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you shall keep my judgments and do them.
Okay. Thank you. So you see how he's stating that I will take you from among the heathen and gather you out of the countries and will bring you into your own land. Our second aim is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. You see, the things that the world is tripping off of right now, he has taken us, he's gathered us from the four corners of the earth. Doesn't matter what you look like, whether you know what color and how tall or short, none of that, because just like a tree, you have a tree, there's a zillion different types of trees, but a tree is still a tree. For a man or one man, you know, we have two eyes, one nose, one mouth. We're made in his likeness and image because of that tabernacle, you know, the most holy place, the holy place in the court round about. There's nine major vessels in that tabernacle, just like in our bodies. We have our head region, our chest region, and our abdominal region, and we have nine major systems within that. So he's made us in his likeness and image, and so, but he's gathered us and he's sprinkled clean water upon us. The water, remember, out of their belly shall flow rivers of living water. The water is the word, and not the word like the people think is in the Bible. We're talking about the words now, the gospel, the good news that he has actually, that's the only way that you can get back home is to know him the way he really is and actually exists. So he has to tell you, but he sprinkled that water on us to make us clean from our filthiness, of whom I was chief. You see, he's taken us from our ignorance, our darkness, our different ways, and he's still working on us with ways and things like that, but he's given us a foundation where we know who our Father is, and he's taken us from our idols. We don't worship nothing here. We so ready to get up out of here. We don't want nothing in here. You know, we're just content with a contrite heart. A new heart will I give you, a new spirit. Can we go back to that other chart, the old covenant and new covenant chart? Because see, their Oceanside class, they have this chart where it shows the stony heart, and in the middle it shows part of the fleshly heart, and it shows the stone crumbling away, and then it shows, you know, the fleshly heart, but it's still the same principle. You know, we came in here, the stony heart, not just our ways and our attitudes and all these things that some have to this day, but the stony heart, the ignorance, the darkness. We did not know him the way he really is and actually exists. The carnal mind and the carnality, the carnal mind is that enmity with Yahweh. So those things that he took us away from this, and he actually gave us a new heart. You see this on the right side, right, your heart and your mind. So a new spirit. Anytime you see a heart, and you'll see on all of the other charts, you'll see a heart. Those represent the spirit. It's the spirit of Yahshua, of Yahweh. And so a new heart has he given us. He's given us a new lease on life, as they would say. I will give you spirit, and I will put it within you, and I will take away the stony heart. You see, the carnality that we actually have, you know, and I'm telling you, you can actually see still now, Just because you know the doctrine, just because you know, understand, listen, Satan knows scriptures. You see, Satan knows scriptures is not just that. It is not only understanding or knowing all of the things. We have charts. We have, which is the vision. We actually have the textbook. We have the book. We have transcript. We have so many different, so much. We have a cloud of witnesses. We have so much material. You're not going to get it all. You're going to get your portion, but we are going to be learning in ages to come. But I will give you, I'm just going to take those things away. And just because you know all of these things, like, this is not a competition. Listen, do you understand that even our doctrine can become a stumbling block? You're going to have to, and I'm going to say that again, even the doctrine itself can become a stumbling block. If you take it with a carnal mind, you're going to have to get rid of that stony heart. It's going to have to be. And he is the only way to do it. He, you know, he has raised some to honor and some to dishonor. So it's just really important to actually just be humble and ask him, where do I stand? You know, because you can see the effectual working of him in us every day. And you can see where he has caused us. As he said, then I will give you a heart of flesh and I will put my spirit within you and cause you. See, you're not going to do it on your own. I don't care what nobody says. I'm going to believe him and he's going to cause you to walk in my statutes, and ye shall keep my judgments and do them because I'm going to cause you to do that. So there's so much more. I have wanted to go up this thing, but I want to yield the floor. Because somebody else may have something to say. Listen, I love all of you guys. And I'm just so grateful and thankful to be here. Because it's not just, if you were buying a new house, you would research that house to your capability or understanding. A car, you would do the same thing before. It's an investment. This is my soul. This is my soul. I want to be pleasing to him. And the only way I can be pleasing to him is to allow him to do whatever it is that he wants to do with me, you know, to bring me up, to teach me what he's going to teach me, and for me to surrender. You know, he has to even cause you to do that. So I surrender and I'm going to yield the floor. All praises, all glory, and all honor belongs only to Yahweh, our Elohim, through Yahshua the Messiah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Mack. And now it is an honor and a privilege to call on the Dean of the Ontario Branch, Dr. Marlon Love.
Good evening.
I was all set up and forgot to turn on the mic. Good evening, everyone. I thoroughly enjoyed the remarks of the previous speakers and the heartfelt desire to want to know Yahweh as he truly is and actually exists, which is our first aim. There were a lot of things expressed and said whereby we have an earnest desire and a zeal to want to know Yahweh. And as it's been stated that Yahweh, having revealed his purpose, it was stated that some didn't even know that Yahweh had a purpose. I didn't know. I was raised in this school for many years. And yet all I was able to do was Paul Parrot, essentially. Just like you have a parrot, Polly wants a cracker. It was told that parrot to say Polly wants a cracker. But we've come to know and understand that Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the year of 1931, had a divine vision and revelation straight from Yahweh. And in his expression and his documentation about that event, he made it evidently clear that he said to make him prove it to your satisfaction. Not for you just to pauper it and go about and memorize and correlate these scriptures. And then, as it's been expressed oftentimes, that he wrote, what, 7 charts, 2 books, and an umpteenth number of pamphlets, around 16 pamphlets by him specifically. There's other pamphlets as well from the other teachers that have graced this gospel in order to help one another learn more about Yahweh. We here, and I appreciate the first speaker, appreciating Ontario Class and liking the desire to come back and sup with us. And it's our only intent and purpose to do such a thing. And we've been having some great classes, if you've been paying attention and following. Dr. Will Williams has been laying down and using a lot of the charts and a lot of the scriptures we're not often commonly familiar with. And that puts a nice flavor in our mouths to want to know more. You know, the last Tuesday class was a humdinger, you know, even for me, you know, talking about 2520, right? And how many ways to use this number effectively in order to do what? Is to win a soul over to Yahshua the Messiah, to point out Yahshua the Messiah, so that that person may have a desire to start at the beginning and to begin to learn something more about his or their creator, right? And now in this school, it's been expressed that our Bibles, the Bibles that we have, are a peculiar book. It's the most written about read book on earth. It's bestseller bar none. As it's been expressed, it's not even on the bestseller list anymore. It just trumps everything. It's been written in some 3,000 languages, and it continues to be used. And there's multiple dialects by which it's written in, right? Languages. In order to, as some people would consider, it's the Word of God. Yet, you grab me John 1:1, please. Yet, and still, they make that statement, and you have John 1:1 that reads this.
John 1:1. Mm-hmm. In the beginning was the Word.
Right there. In the beginning was the Word. That Word and the Bible are two different things. In the beginning was the Word. In the beginning was not the Bible. But understand that that Word is what was written about in the Bible. Because we understand that that Word or Son is Elohim, right? Elohim is a title, it's not a name. It's a title that Yahweh gave himself, because it's through his word that things are expressed and brought forth through his word. Now we have a Bible that was written by the fathers or the patriarchs of Moses, of Joshua through Malachi. It was brought up Isaiah 8:20 earlier. That by the scriptures, we don't speak according to the scriptures. There's no light or understanding, you see, that's in an individual. So it's by the scriptures in which this word wrote through our patriarchs, starting with Moses. And it's been expressed that we come to this school and we are shown that in that Bible and how it's put together, that that Bible starts with Moses, or Exodus, the 3rd chapter, here at this burning bush, you follow? When Moses was 80 years old, tending to his father-in-law's sheep, he's come upon this burning bush that was burning but was not being consumed. Now, there's a whole lot to understand in that, but that begins the structure of one's Bible. Now, we've been going over, that's all I need there, John, with that word became flesh. because that book or that Bible never became flesh, right? Your Bible, whatever language you want to read in it, read out of it, it's not going to make you flesh, you see? But that word or that spirit at an appointed time here on this chart, this Moses chart, it's here depicts the word, right? It's the word or son that transformed from out of pure spirit into a form. Pure spirit having no shape and form, because you have this cloud. We talked about it in moderation, that Yahweh is spirit. We had that read earlier today. And he's manifesting within the cloud, symbolizing eternity. Yahweh's spirit. And this is what this cloud is symbolized as. Now, out of this pure spirit state and condition, he, Yahweh, formed a formation known as Elohim, whereby it can be seen and understood through a vision and a revelation. That form or that condition also transformed into a fleshly body known as Yahshua the Messiah. You follow? Two manifestations of the one Yahweh. Okay? Now, we were been talking about this tabernacle pattern. We understand when you follow that story out of Exodus down into Egypt, whereby Yahweh had Moses to come down into Egypt for a period of time. And therefore, coming out of Egypt, he sees this tabernacle. Moses sees this tabernacle in a vision. Because I tried to find it in moderation, because it says here that Moses was shown this tabernacle pattern, an incorporeal tabernacle pattern. When he's shown this, it's incorporeal. It's not flesh. You follow? It's not physical. This is what Moses saw in his consciousness. He was told to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai based off of what he was shown in his consciousness. Now, this school is all about our consciousness, that we're trying to get reconciled unto Yahweh and to be able to see what Yahweh has shown Moses, Moses and John together. Because we're going to read here in a minute about John and Moses. So we're going to go and try to have a half an hour, should be able to get to it. And what we're going to do, we're going to go over this tabernacle pattern, and we're going to go over the migratory pattern. These are the steps that we've been, you know, kind of hitting on, and it makes sense because these are the things that captures our soul or our imagination about how can it be, you follow? And this is what we want to be able to impart to somebody when we're teaching them about this Bible or about this creation or about whatever you might be dealing with them with, because you're going to have to come back to this tabernacle pattern because it's a pattern of heavenly things. You follow? Mm-hmm. So let's go ahead and read out of volume one of the textbook, since it's been stated earlier that we have these tools. So we want to utilize these tools to the best of our ability to be able to draw out some points, and slow it down a little bit for new people, because it's a repetition, you follow? So I'm not knowing who I'm speaking to oftentimes, we just let it roll, right? So we're going to do a little reading out of page 69, right, on volume 1. It's going to be the vision of Moses and the Apostle John, like I just said, in comparative analysis or apostolic confirmation of the creation of the old, of the old and of the new heaven and earth as pertaining to the purpose of Yahweh. That's what we started off saying. Yahweh had a purpose. And he showed Moses something atop of Mount Sinai, and he showed John something on top of a mountain, because an island is no more than a raised mountain out of the water. You follow? That's a correlation to see that we're talking about the same thing. You follow? Just as like last week, you have this Mount Transfiguration of Yahshua that's shown to Peter, James, and John. You follow? See, this is in the fulfillment of this trip here, this second trip into the mountain that Moses had when he brought up Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu. Aaron being the father or the elder, Nadab and Abihu being two brothers. You have Peter being the elder, and you have James and John being two brothers. They're correlating and confirming this event. You follow? That's a correlation, right? So we're going to use what John said and what Moses said, and we're going to read here what the founder had talked about. First two paragraphs.
Okay. The only reason for writing this summary is because there are many world-famous theologians and biblical commentators who do not believe that the Mosaic vision and writings of the Pentateuch, or the first five books of the Bible, have anything in particular to do with the vision. With the vision and the book of Revelation.
Now, right there. We're saying that theologians worldwide, they are not going to see how Moses and the Apostle John are talking about the same thing. That book of Revelations to the theologians have nothing to do with what Moses saw. This is something that the founder had brought to our awareness, that what John is writing about on the Isle of Patmos, being accredited for writing five books himself, John, 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, and the book of Revelations. Just like Moses wrote the first five books. That's a correlation that is getting you to see a similar likeness to these two guys. Five books of Moses, five books of John. John's on a mountain, Moses is on a mountain. Moses sees a vision, John has seen a vision about Yahshua the Messiah. And he's talking about the self-same thing. You follow? That's what that first paragraph stated. Keep reading.
Written by the Apostle John on the Isle of Patmos in the
Aegean Sea.
Mm-hmm. To entertain such an erroneous idea is to deny that all scripture is given by the inspiration of Yahweh and is profitable for doctrine, mm-hmm. for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness.
Now that's what that Bible's for. You follow? I didn't say the Bible wasn't worth anything. I just said it is not the word of Yahweh. You follow? It's not the word. You follow? Not the word that we're referring to as Elohim. You have to make that the distinct difference. So keep reading.
In order to prove the fallacy of such a mistaken conclusion, we will begin this summary by correlating the experiences and visions of Moses with the experiences and visions of the Apostle John.
Now, that's why I just went through, right? Moses is on top of a mountain, seeing a vision. John's on top of the mountain, seeing a vision. Moses wrote five books. John wrote five books. That's very elementary. You follow? Now, there's more because you're going to see this 7 days of the creation that Moses saw, right? Then you're going to see how John is writing in a abstract way that Moses has seen it. That's what confuses the people. So we have to see how these correlations, we must see how these correlations connect. You follow? And that's what makes Revelations a difficult book for many. But if a person says that they don't understand Revelations, then you don't understand Moses. You follow? So keep reading.
According to the purpose of Yahweh, mm-hmm. who is the archetype pattern of the universe, mm-hmm. reflecting himself in the first three of these physical patterns as recorded in the Pentateuch, namely Noah's Ark, the Exodus and migration from Egypt through the wilderness of Sinai to Canaan's land, mm-hmm. the tabernacle erected by the prophet Moses, and the temple in Jerusalem recorded in 1 Kings 6:1-38. And 2 Chronicles 2.
Mm-hmm. According to the purpose of Yahweh.
according to the purpose of Yahweh, all visions, revelations, prophecies, and experiences must follow Yahweh, the Yahweh Elohim given pattern of the migration, tabernacle, and temple.
Now, that's good. Thank you. So, we see the importance of that from Genesis to Revelations. It has to go according to the Elohim, or the archetype, or original pattern of the universes, right? Which he's given a key, which is this tabernacle pattern. Grab me, I got to make it quick. That's okay, we don't need it. So this is the key. This was the key you read about there, I believe in Luke, talks about the key that was taken away from the people. You were talking about this tabernacle pattern. Grab it for me. I said it. I think it's Luke 11. That's okay. Grab it for me, Luke.
Okay, so it's Luke 11. And you got it?
51.
Okay, try it.
Is it okay? From the blood of Abel unto the blood of Zechariah, which perished between the altar and the temple. Verily I say unto you, it shall be required of this generation. Woe unto you, lawyers, for ye have taken away the key of knowledge. Ye enter not in yourselves, and them that were entering in ye hindered.
Very good. See, those lawyers and the scribes and Pharisees, they took away that key of knowledge. This is why we're referring to and going over this migratory pattern in comparison with this tabernacle pattern. Now, what we're going to do, we're going to use the textbook to go through it one more time. On page 67, volume 1, you're going to have the migratory pattern. And it's going to run down the seven steps from the gate to the holy place, most holy place. Follow? So we're just going to go through here. Anybody have any questions, you can interrupt or ask questions. But let's start reading.
Okay, the migratory pattern, plate number 13, illustrates a perfect threefold pattern established by the migration of the Israelites from Egypt to Canaan land and the greater and more perfect tabernacle, the universe, which Yahweh Elohim himself built and not the man Moses. In the outer court, plate 13e, is Egypt, where the Israelites were in bondage to Pharaoh, the typical man of sin, having the mark of the beast. After Elohim poured out nine plagues upon the Egyptians, he, Elohim, instituted the first Passover with Israel. And simultaneously with the pouring out of the 10th and the last plague, in which the firstborn of all the Egyptians were slain, when the angel of Yahweh passed over Egypt. The slaying of the Paschal Lamb in Egypt. Okay.
1 second. So this is plate 13 that's in your textbook. It's the same plate as the one here, but there's some more things were drawn out on this plate. So we're going to use this plate in comparison to the tabernacle plate. So the first step of this tabernacle pattern of the seven steps is the gate. You follow? The gate into the tabernacle. Now, that gate is synonymous to this door that the children of Israel had to go in to their homes in order to prepare this sacrifice. You follow? So that's the entering into their home when Yahweh gave the decree before the 10th plague that they had to come into this, into their homes in order to perform what we're about to read now. Okay?
Okay. The slaying of the Paschal Lamb in Egypt is comparable to the sacrifice slain on the altar in the pattern of the tabernacle, plate 1E.
Now, with plate 1E, we don't, you show that plate 1A right there, right there. So if you look on that plate E and the lower portion, that's it. So E, you're dealing with this lower portion. This is why you have it here on this chart. And you can zoom in on this chart on here. See, this is A. B is 6 is B. C is the holy place. The veil here in the area is C, and then you have E. Okay, D and E, right? C, D, and E, right? Yes. Down here at the lower portion within this court round, the court round about is this whole section, but it's divided in half here. Moses and Aaron and Pharaoh, right? You're dealing with it down here during this Passover time. It says Passover, the feast of blood of the sacrificial lamb. Can you follow? And the Israelites in Egypt, they had to come into their homes in order to prepare this sacrifice. Read.
The slaying of the Paschal lamb and the sprinkling of the blood of the lamb, plate 13E, on the side doorpost and over the lintel of the door, and the blood in the basin was figurative to Yahshua the Messiah, mm-hmm. as shown in plate 31E, mm-hmm. our Passover, the Lamb of Yahweh nailed to the cross.
Now, so now we have step one is the gate, step two is this brazen altar of sin offering, which the animals were sacrificed on. And then on this sacrifice, the blood of that innocent sacrifice was put on these four horns on this altar. Just like this, they had to put the four points of blood on the door, the lintel and the two side posts, and they dipped it from the basin. It's also correlative to Yahshua the Messiah, having been nailed in his hands, nailed in his feet, and a crown of thorns, which crown of thorns on his head, which drew blood. These four points are correlative to this altar here, or this second step. You follow? Keep reading.
Okay, you skipped that part. And it was night in Egypt, mm-hmm. when the Passover lamb was slain. Mm-hmm. Likewise, it turned dark over the face of the earth when Yahshua was on the cross from the sixth to the ninth hour, mm-hmm. after slaying of the firstborn in the land of Egypt. Pharaoh let the Israelites go, but afterwards he pursued them to the Red Sea.
Now, so when we're using this tabernacle, we get the blood and the four points, but now we're expanding into this other plate that he's using, plate 31, I believe. Or this is not a plate. Yeah, that's fine. It's the Isaiah, the death, burial, and resurrection of Yahshua Messiah. Either one. This one still points out that when Yahshua died, you see how it's black all around him here? Because he died when he took off the flesh at the 12 o'clock or the sixth hour to the ninth hour, it became dark. You follow? And so therefore you have that correlative to when the children of Israel had to eat that sacrificial lamb while they were down here in Egypt. So it's correlative here. And we can correlate if you have this dark cross here. 1 Corinthians 5:7 expresses that lamb of Yahweh being crucified at night, just as they ate that sacrifice at night. You follow? Keep reading.
The Red Sea is compared to the brazen laver in the pattern of the tabernacle, mm-hmm. and to Joseph's new tomb in which Yahshua was laid. The records reveal, as shown in plate 13D, that Elohim, by the phenomenal cloud and the hand of Moses, brought the Israelites through the miraculously divided waters of the Red Sea, mm-hmm. immersing or baptizing them in the cloud and in the Red Sea. Overthrowing the pursuing Pharaoh, the typical beast man of sin, and his host therein. This baptism in the cloud and in the Red Sea is compared to the priest washing in the brazen laver, stitched in plate 1, and Yahshua being buried or baptized in Joseph's new tomb. Okay. Judas, the beast man of sin, having committed suicide and buried in the potter's field, is compared to Pharaoh, who was drowned and buried in the Red Sea.
Okay, very good. So we're dealing with step three now with this water or this laver in this tabernacle, right? We just read through here that this water or this laver is synonymous to the Red Sea. Because the children of Israel were baptized in the cloud and in the sea, or they were immersed. Just as they washed the high priest and the two low priests washed out of this laver, they washed that sacrifice that was put on this altar. You follow? That's what we're correlating. And we see how this burial now, you have Yahshua being buried in Joseph's new tomb. He's immersed in there. Now, you don't see water anywhere, but the principle of the immersion is what we're talking about, that new tomb. That's where we get the principle of being buried in a tomb. You follow? Now, you just read here that Judas, who sold out Yahshua Messiah, he was buried in the potter's field. You follow? And then he is like into the beast man of sin from turning against Yahshua, as it were, by purpose. And then you have that same principle with Pharaoh and his host being buried or drowned in the Red Sea. That's all correlative in order to bring us up to an understanding of a principle that's immutable and nothing changed. That which keeps that story connected. Now we're talking about Yahshua the Messiah here in the so-called New Testament, reading about these things, which you can't read about Joseph's new tomb nowhere in the Old Testament. You follow? Although it really took place in the Old Testament, but out of your Bible setup, you don't see this new tomb being talked about in that Old Testament. You follow? Because the way the theologians and the people who wrote that book, they wrote it in air, as far as the placement of things, as it were. But all things by the will of Yahweh. Keep reading. That's step three. Read.
Okay. Three, you said path?
No,
or
no.
Just go ahead.
Just keep
okay.
Going.
3 days after the slaying of the Paschal Lamb, mm-hmm. the Israelites came into or were resurrected into the wilderness or holy place, mm-hmm. just as the priest entered into the sanctuary or holy place. As Joshua raised from the dead 3 days after his crucifixion, mm-hmm. the wilderness of Sinai represents the holy place in the migratory pattern. Mm-hmm. Herein, the Israelites received the manna from heaven and then the Ten Commandment law and the divine pattern of the tabernacle during the total time of their sojourn. Therein, they were led by the phenomenal cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night.
That's good.
While they were being
That's good.
Tempted. Okay.
Right now, so we talked about step one, the gate, step two, the altar, step three, this laver. Now we're talking about step four of them 3 days journey to and through the Red Sea. You follow? And they were led by a phenomenal cloud. Now, again, we're talking about symbolisms. Yahweh used a cloud to symbolize himself. Yahweh is not a cloud, but he used a cloud to symbolize himself, right? So therefore, that's what we said in the moderation. Now we see here that the children of Israel followed a cloud. Now we're talking about a principle in this holy place, in the roundabout area here, that the high priest and two low priests, before they were able to minister in this tabernacle, had to be anointed by this holy cup of anointing oil at the door. The door represents our fourth step. It represents that resurrection, if you would. With that anointing, being that oil or quickening, you have that cloud, which is like into the spirit. And you have an angel in that was in that cloud as well, bringing our attention to a quickening spirit. And because it's Yahweh who quickens. When Yahshua was resurrected, on the third day, he resurrected a quickening spirit. You follow? That's what that holy cup of anointing oil represented that the high priests were inundated in at the door, or the fourth step. You follow? And it's through this Red Sea, or this opening that would happen to the Red Sea, right? It opened up like into a way or a door into the holy place. They went and grabbed five abreast, which typifies spirit. Number five, right? The fifth step into the holy place. You have the fourth step, the door, and the high priest and the two low priests are able to go into the sanctuary to minister therein with the light, with the bread, and the intercessor. You follow? Just like Yahshua expressed that he was the light of the world. He was the door. Follow him. He's the way, the truth, and the life. And then he's also the intercessor between man and man. Okay? The same thing in the wilderness. We're going to read here with this cloud represented and why the children of Israel had to follow it for the 40 years. Keep reading.
Okay. All right, so in that they were tempted of the devil 40 years and one day for a year. Mm-hmm. The wilderness was comparable to the holy place mm-hmm. of the pattern of the tabernacle mm-hmm. where the priests performed the daily services of Yahweh. Mm-hmm. The children of Israel being baptized in the Red Sea mm-hmm. and tarrying in the wilderness for 40 years is also comparable to Yahshua tarrying in the wilderness of Judea for 40 days following his baptism, after which he was tempted of the devil mm-hmm. and after his resurrection from the dead, after Yahshua the Messiah appeared to his disciples in incorporeal form, he tarried on earth for 40 days before he ascended through the second veil and entered into heaven.
So
the dividing.
Okay. So you have this principle 40. You have the children of Israel in the wilderness or the holy place or the fifth step for 40 years. You have on the tabernacle, you have a 40 by which you have 10 feet in between each one of these vessels here. From the door to the candlestick is 10. The candlestick all the way around, you have a principle of 40 here, right? And then we talked about two times when Yahshua was fulfilling, when he was, after he was baptized, of John, right? And John announced that saw that dove descending, and only John saw this dove, or this semblance of this, a vision that he had, that Yahshua was the one for him to be the trumpeter or the announcer of the Lamb of Yahweh. Behold, the Lamb of Yahweh, right? He, John the Baptist, being the last prophet, if you would, sanctioned that Yahshua is the one. And we know that in that there in Matthew, the third chapter, it talks about Yahshua going straightway into the wilderness. You follow? And he's there for 40 days. Just like the children of Israel was a day for a year that they resided here in the Canaan's land. Then after the resurrection of Yahshua the Messiah, after the resurrection of Yahshua the Messiah down here, after the resurrection of Yahshua the Messiah, he tarried on earth for 40 days, appearing to whomever he willed himself to appear to. Not everybody saw him, just those that he willed himself to see. Okay? Keep reading.
The dividing of the River Jordan, or second veil, mm-hmm. permitting the Israelites to pass over into Canaan's land, mm-hmm. led by Yahshua, served as a division between the wilderness and Canaan's land, just as the veil divided the holy place and the most holy place. The veil is also shown in plate 31 by the removal of the flesh of Yahshua, being sown a natural body and raised a spiritual. Mm-hmm. This was proven by the rending of the veil in the temple when the Messiah rose from the dead.
Now, you have mm-hmm. this sixth step now, which is the second veil in this temple, in the tabernacle, right? That's the sixth step. And we're correlating this veil like unto the flesh. And this flesh is this veil is symbolic of this River Jordan. You follow? So this is the comparison you're making, the River Jordan to this veil, and we're making the veil reference to Yahshua Messiah when he ascended or went through from appearing for 40 days and ascending in the children of Israel's consciousness, if you would. Or that veil piercing from out of a concrete state into a corporate real estate that can be seen. This is, and then when Yahshua died on the cross, that veil was rent that was in the temple. So you have a veil here, which kept anyone from seeing into the most holy place. You follow? Yahshua, upon his fulfilling of the veil, rent it down the middle. Just as the River Jordan was rent or opened for the children of Israel to go through the midst of it. So you see a tearing here. You see a tearing of this veil, but was in the temple that Yahshua performed in fulfillment of these things to be able to be have access to the most holy place. Keep reading.
The promised land of Canaan is a type of heaven where David was anointed king of Israel and sat upon his throne in the city of Jerusalem. Mm-hmm. Canaan land is compared to the most holy place mm-hmm. in the pattern of the tabernacle, mm-hmm. where the presence of Yahweh appeared in the cloud above the mercy seat on the Ark of the Covenant between the cherubims, representing the throne of Yahweh. Mm-hmm. Also comparable to the promised land of Canaan is the ascension of the Messiah, with the Messiah sitting upon the throne of Yahweh mm-hmm. in the heavenly Jerusalem, mm-hmm. being mighty ruler and king of kings.
That's what this chart is down here. Because this is an upward, this chart here is an upward operating chart, right? The pattern. His death, his burial, and then his resurrection and ascension, and now he's sitting on the throne of Yahweh here. 10 days after he ascended, those 40 days, right? And so now he's here on this throne. And expressing that this temple, now David wasn't, David didn't minister in this temple, his son Solomon did. But the principle is the same, whereby David received the vision about how to construct this temple. You follow? This is the third thing that Yahweh had man to build. The other two things are what? This tabernacle that they built in the wilderness, mm-hmm. right? And then you mm-hmm. have Noah's ark. When he preached to Noah to build him an ark. So therefore you have David being singled out here because he, in his consciousness, he was already sitting on the throne of Yahweh. Because he was given the divine specification of how to build it, and he knew what it was going to be looking like. You follow? Father David, son Solomon. Father in Yahshua is the fulfilling of the ascension to Yahweh, being returning back unto the Father. You follow? See how that works? He is the Father, as it were. He's not his little boy, as it mentioned earlier. He didn't ascend up and sit on his right hand and Yahweh patting him on the back type of thing. That is Yahweh returning mm-hmm. into himself or back into himself, just as David was like unto the Father that had the whole specifications of this temple that was constructed physically by King Solomon. So this is why it's referenced David and not Solomon. But keep reading. Should be a little bit more.
Okay. It goes into the vision of Moses. That's where we started.
Was that the concluding?
Yes.
No, keep reading.
Okay, so now we're at the vision of Moses and the Apostle John.
Now read the last script, read the last paragraph and we'll be done. No, right there. Yeah, on that page. Here and now. So we went through talking about.
Okay.
We went through talking about how John and Moses are talking about the same thing, right? That's what we started off with. Then we went back and we talked about Moses and the children of Israel and this migratory pattern, and we compared it to the tabernacle pattern. You follow? Now we're going to read an excerpt of when and how you can take what John is seeing and Moses is seeing, and Dr. Kinley goes into it line by line according to what they're talking about together. But just leave this last paragraph, and as a homework assignment, you can read the synopsis of the rest of these things. Go ahead and read.
Okay. Here and now, we intend or aim to show the experiences of Moses down in Egypt,
okay,
and the vision and experiences given to him in 1490 BY.
Okay.
And thereafter in the wilderness of Sinai, that's, in correlation to the Apostle John's vision and experiences during the 3.5 years from AD 30 to AD 33.5. While he was with Yahshua during the time of his early ministry, and to John's vision given in AD 96 on the Isle of Patmos, which together depict the summation of the whole matter. Mm-hmm. It is the migratory pattern, or the journey from Egypt through the wilderness of Sinai to Canaan's land with Moses, Joshua, and the children of Israel, mm-hmm, that we mainly desire to refer in, showing the infinite relationship, mm-hmm, of the experiences and visions of John.
See, that's the synopsis, and this is why we go over these here, so we understand some of the primary points, and there's an exhaustive amount of comparisons that we can see that the John is writing in Revelations, because Revelation is the revelation of that which Moses wrote in the first five books. So I hope that was a bit of a slowdown, and that we've gotten a bit of information about the comparison between the tabernacle pattern and the migratory pattern. So with that, we'll conclude. Hallelujah.
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 This concludes this evening's lecture. Whole classes. 1816 East Elma Court in Ontario, California, on Tuesdays from 7 p.m. to 9 p.m., Thursdays from 7:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m., and Sundays from 10 a.m. to 12 p.m. Please bring your enemies and friends. This is the place to learn about our Heavenly Father. I'll stand and be dismissed with the doxology taken from the last two verses of the book of Jude. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. Only wise Elohim.